go ahead and get started. We've got a good group here. I'm so happy about that. Cool. Right. Thanks so much, everybody, for coming. It's so great to see your faces. If you are comfortable turning on your camera, we would love to see even more of your faces. I want to introduce April Bey. She received her BFA in drawing from 2009 from Ball State University. Excuse me, and her MFA in painting in 2014 from California State University, Northridge, which is actually how we know one another. April grew up in the Bahamas, New Providence, and now resides and works in Los Angeles, California as a visual artist and art educator. Bey's interdisciplinary artwork is an introspective and social critique of American and Bahamian culture, contemporary pop culture, feminism, generational theory, social media, Afrofuturism, Afro-surrealism, post-colonialism, and constructs of race within white supremacist systems. I'm so excited to have April here today. It's been 1,000 years since I've seen her. And I just want to welcome her and all of you that are here. So go ahead, April, you can take it away whenever you're ready.
Okay, so I do a very casual version of a talk where I start from when I was in school. I'm gonna show some works and explain what I was thinking and going through at the time. And I would highly suggest that you write down any questions you have as I'm going through to ask at the end. Usually there's a lot of questions at the end and I welcome them. We're starting with the last time I was home in the Bahamas, where I'm from. And this is important because a lot of my work has intersections between growing up in the Caribbean. I grew up on this island here and this island here, New Providence and Eleuthera. And also like my proximity to the US, because I'm also part African American, and intersections between the African continent. And colonialism kind of ties all three identities. So this is when I went to grad school at CSUN for my MFA, and my major was in painting, but CSUN is like an interdisciplinary program, so they kind of expect grad students to experiment in all disciplines, which is similar to my undergrad as well. My undergrad is in drawing, but to get the degree, you're required to take all disciplines up to the advanced level. So I have a pretty good understanding of all processes. When I was in grad school, I was starting to investigate brands, online culture, and also, like, in particular, the Black community. I was investigating YouTube as a site for millennials in particular, Black women and Black millennials, to show other Black millennials using YouTube how to go natural. So to explain that, Black people have to chemically relax their natural hair to get it straight. And so at the time I was trying to understand, when I started grad school, that was the first time I went natural. So I entered the program with like half of my hair natural and the other half straight. And I was really self-conscious, and like in talking to my advisors, they were like, so why do you think relaxing your hair is so important in the Black community? So I started reading a lot about, you know, white supremacy, supremacy in general, colonialism, and the aesthetic that we were going for. I was also collaborating a lot with a graphic designer, and so we started doing research on brands and how brands work in perpetuating anti-Blackness. And so this brand in particular, PCJ, No Lie Hair Relaxer, this was the brand I grew up using. So I did 4 photographic prints of the actual packaging and painted hair relaxer on top. And within seconds, the hair relaxer started dissolving the photo emulsion, which was really interesting because through the process of using hair relaxer in grad school, I was required to prove that it was safe. And so my argument in grad school was, we put this on our hair, it's safe. Like, we put it in our skin and stuff. And then I started collaborating with the chemistry department and the biology department and looking at it under a microscope. And I was like, oh yeah. So like in screen printing, the same chemicals used in hair relaxer is used on screen printing screens as haze remover. It's like the last thing you use if you can't get the image out of the screen. And the chemical is the same. The only difference is that hair relaxers have a little less of the acid in it, and it has perfumes. So it smells good. So, like I said, I was also doing work about internet culture. And one of the ways I was literally learning how to do my hair was by watching other women on YouTube. Now, some of these women at the time in grad school were just making videos in their bathrooms. Since I graduated grad school, these women are like millionaires at this point. They have their own hair product lines and like have since divorced their husbands and like are taking care of themselves. And it's wild. But at the time, they were helping me with my research for my thesis. And I wanted a project where I could get strangers from the internet to send me selfies of themselves with their natural hair. And what better platform to use than these women who are building up their brands and already had like hundreds of thousands of followers. So they put the call out. The call still exists. So this is an ongoing piece for people to submit their selfies with their natural hair. This installation was done twice. The first time when I was in grad school at my first solo show in the Bahamas. And then shortly after graduating, the California African American Museum commissioned the installation. The piece is called Picky Head. And Picky Head is a Bahamian term that we use to insult one another if your hair isn't relaxed or if it's like too natural looking, it's picky. So like someone will scream to you, yeah, yeah, picky now. So an English equivalent, a US equivalency would be nappy. So like if you hear someone say you have nappy hair. And so Picky Head is spelt out in about 4 gallons of hair relaxer. And it's been, it's a very tedious and stressful process. It's like I make these handmade stencils out of foam. And then you'll have to forgive me. I have a Siberian Husky that just decided she's going to lay down quietly behind me, hopefully. So I make the handmade stencils and mix up the hair relaxer, which as you can see starts out white. So if you remember on the last slide, you see how it turns yellow? As air oxidizes hair relaxer, it turns this piss yellow and then eventually this orange. So the installation in the museum, over the weeks, it was up for 3 months. And by the time it came down, it was red and orange, and it smelled the whole museum up. And like I said, this piece is bigger now. So this piece right here at the museum currently has about 8,000 selfies on paper. So you can kind of see the stencils. And the hair relaxer eventually drips. So I'm still in grad school, and at this point, I'm still very much collaborating with the biology department, and I have this tendency in my life as a, just me personally, where if something hurts, I want to see what it looks like. Can anyone relate to that? Like, if you have a pain in your body, in your thigh or something, you want to know what it looks like in your flesh. Like, what is that that's causing pain? Or like, if you get something stuck in your teeth, you want to know, like, where is it at? So in regards to chemically relaxing black textured hair, I wanted to know what it looked like. Like what it looked like in real time when that was happening. What causes hair that grows out of my scalp straight up to then fall straight, right? Why do black people have hair that is like this and white people have hair like this? Like what's the difference? How does that work? So I went into the biology department and they had this like, they had one of those expensive microscopes that you see on like CSI shows where they show like DNA and stuff. And I was like, I want to see my hair being relaxed. And I went in there and the first day I was so lost because I was like, he showed me how to set everything up, but didn't explain to me that those videos we see on TV, you know, like when you watch a movie like Outbreak and they're showing the virus moving and like attacking something, it's actually like time lapse. It's not like you can't see that stuff in real life with the naked eye. And so it took me a couple of weeks to get the footage. But at the same time, I was watching this show on HBO called The Wire. I don't know how many people have seen The Wire. It's kind of an old HBO show, but I was watching it to get an idea of American blackness and like inner cityness and the concept of like our politicians who are black from our community finally getting up there and then not doing what they said they would do. It's a common issue in like post-colonial countries, especially like places like Africa and the Bahamas. You always wonder why we have such corrupt government, and that's why, because oftentimes it's better to just make your money and help your family than it is to like actually do the things that you promised to do when you got elected. So in The Wire, there's a politician character that I became obsessed with named Clay Davis. And every scene where he and his like corruptedness, where he's being called out on being corrupt, or his plans aren't going the way he wants, he'll say, "Shit." And so I went through and found like every incidence of that in the film, and kind of juxtaposed it with what I was doing in the lab. So I'll for those of you who haven't seen the show, I'll show you this video. Oops. Sorry. I don't know why it's not working. Give me a second. There, I knew it had to be something with giving my own document permission that I created on the same computer. Sorry about that. Anybody have any ideas why it disappeared?
I've actually never seen that before.
Like the easiest way to give artist talks, because it's embedded. And let's see. I'll try to open and close again. I apologize, everyone.
Shit.
Okay, here we go.
Think I'm gonna be the scapegoat for the whole damn machine? Shit.
Clarence is gonna...
Shit, as far as the federal money is concerned, he's everything. The faucet, the goose.
A goose.
The one that lays them golden eggs. Major crimes. Shit. Ain't gonna come talk to me about money laundering in West Baltimore? Shit. Looking forward to working with you.
Shouldn't you be dead to me?
Shit. I took it easy on you, son.
High in the sky.
Shit, partner. And it's your people up in my shit. Not no feds, not no fake people from Annapolis. It's motherfuckers from my own city. All that profile? Shit. Partner, you should be paying me a fee. Maurice Dobie? For governor of my state? Shit.
All right. So here's the actual piece that I created, which consists of stills of time, like time-lapsed stills of my hair being chemically relaxed under a microscope. So that was the video. Basically, what I learned is that hair relaxer chemically kills all of the cones on your hair. So your hair is made up of cones. People with different textures of hair, the cones go a certain way. Black people have like way more cones than we need, and that's what causes the hair to curl in a complete circle. And what the hair relaxer chemical does is it completely kills the cone, so it relaxes. And it's hair is already dead, but it's like hella dead when you chemically relax your hair. Same thing when you get a perm, which is the opposite, right? It makes your hair curly. So I just found that fascinating. And I just loved how like all of the adults in my life let me do that to myself from like 5 years of age until I was 21. So for like that length of time, I did not know what my hair looked like. And that blew my mind. And I was like, wow, like white supremacy and like colonialism just like had me hating myself. So now I have graduated grad school. Yay! And I taught a somewhat controversial class at Art Center on Beyonce. And then I, you know, slid into a full-time job at Glendale. So the first year I was there, I was getting into all kinds of trouble because I was working with people who just did not know how to respond to students when it came to racial issues that we were experiencing. And I have this image up here to show you the article that I sent. So at my school, we have this email listserv where faculty can have debates about politics. So basically it's a lot of intellectual pontification, and like, it can get pretty heated because we have like Trump supporting faculty, we have non-Trump supporting faculty, we have independents. So it's a listserv for academics to argue with each other. And one of my colleagues posted in there after yet another police shooting that we should all wear safety pins to show our solidarity to Black students. Now at the time I was like the faculty advisor for the Black Student Union, and I emailed out this article in response to this professor, but this was emailed to me from the Black students who were like, we don't want the safety pin like gesture. If faculty want to show that they care about us, donate to Black Lives Matter and then, you know, safety pin the receipt on your shirt. How about that? And the white male faculty member who sent the initial email got really offended and was like, you don't understand what we're trying to do for you. And like, you're offending me and my feelings matter. And so basically, long story short, my tenure was threatened and I was told not to like post in the discussion forum. Like the one and only Black full-time faculty was told not to post in the issues thread that we all have a right to post in about the actual Black students' response to faculty wearing safety pins. Like they felt it was very like offensive. Okay, so now we're getting back into my work. So I wasn't tenured, and if you don't have tenure, you basically don't have any rights. Like you have to keep quiet and do what everyone says. So I did, but I have my art and I don't keep quiet in my art. So on that article, I decided to collect all of the memes that were posted by Black women in response to white people having issues with the safety pin. And I created a piece called The White Fragility Quilt, which are memes from Black women in reaction to white people, telling them how to accept their help. And of course, I needed to find thousands of safety pins to construct this quilt out of. So the quilt is paper that is held together with thousands of safety pins. And like, this is one of those accidents where when it's done, the actual physical piece ends up being your content. Because when the gallery manager was installing this, he was like, you can't fart and like the piece stay intact. Like you can't even breathe. It's like trying to fall apart and rip. It's so fragile. And I was like, oh, that's because it's the White Fragility Quilt. He did not in fact think that that was funny, but I thought it was funny. I thought it was hilarious. This is the piece installed. This piece also started directing me towards textiles, patterns, fabric. Okay. And I really am an academic. I do a lot of research before I make my work, partly because I have anxiety and I'm always anxious that I'm going to Columbus someone else, even though I come from a marginalized background. And so I'm like, it doesn't take that much longer to just, you know, fly to West Africa and ask the actual women who are selling the fabric, like what I can do to like make my work about what I'm interested in, but also give back. And so I got a research grant and started in Indonesia with batik fabric, which I was pleasantly surprised to see is still using African, West African Adinkra symbols in their work all the way in Indonesia, which is a direct result of Dutch colonialization or the attempt at Dutch colonialism. And I have women up and down the West African coast that I interview and that I source my fabrics from. the thing that I focus on in my work is how China has colonialized the African wax fabric trade. And this is seen to be bad. However, the actual people who live there, who have to, now the fabrics that you're seeing here are fabrics that like West Africans use in school uniforms, in like nursing uniforms. They wear, they make their clothes and they wear clothes with these fabrics. So the thing about African-made fabric versus Chinese knockoff fabric is that the African-made fabric, the actual Africans can't afford, right? So they're priced to be, so the company I'm talking about is called Vlisco. It's a Dutch company. And they produce fabrics with the target audience of people in London. Like LA has a Vlisco store, okay? So like these are countries that are like, look at our African fabric. We're a Dutch-owned company. And the founders of the Dutch-owned company really only went to textiles because slavery became illegal. And we know our history about the Dutch and the slave castles in West Africa, right? So I thought it was interesting that now the Dutch company that colonized African taste and style is now saying that Africans shouldn't buy Chinese knockoffs, when in all actuality, the process of printing this fabric was invented by the Chinese in the 8th century. So they're kind of really only knocking off themselves. And it's the only fabric that the actual Africans can afford. So, and I wouldn't have known that if I didn't go there and actually talk to the women in the markets. And also, while I was spending so much time in West Africa worrying about instances on the toilet and trying to figure out my French and my Wolof, I realized that like what I had been seeing my whole life in the Caribbean as what Africa is wasn't true. So like, yes, it's true, a whole ass goat could be standing next to your car taking a dump and someone could be eating next to it and there could be an open cesspit. But then at the same time, someone could be walking down the same street covered in foil, looking like an Afrofuturist astronaut with hot pink hair on their way to an Afrofuturist festival around the corner. It's like, I'm not going to say it's like Wakanda, because I think that was like a Hollywood version, but like, it's wild. It's so wild. Like you can meet a famous African musician on the bus and then they're just like, oh, you should come to my show. And you think it's like a small little tiny like live music bar. And it's like a whole ass conference that people that like Solange is there for. It's such a weird place and like nothing ever goes the way it's supposed to, but then it always does. So this is like the first piece I did to kind of like introduce people to this concept of Atlantica, which is a fictitious planet. The back story of Atlantica comes from like a story my dad told me when I was getting teased in school because I looked different. And he was like, you know, you and me will always look different because we're from another planet and we were sent to Earth to observe and report. And so now in my work, I'm developing this planet as like a world building exercise. This, I'm showing the most famous paintings that I'm like burnt out on seeing, but everyone always uses. This was from my first solo show in LA. And my process emulates the process I go through to get research to like, it took me so long to get like women in the market to trust me because like they're not technically supposed to be selling Chinese knockoff fabric, but like to have the conversations I need to have around why they do, like we have to trust each other. So this is like this is a painting on wood that's covered in resin. And then there are holes drilled so that I can sew through that. And then the text I will not is oil, paint, and pasto. Better understanding if you see the painting from the back. And these are inspirational posters / protest posters that an Atlantican would produce. And I'm gonna start like giving you guys like some of the origin story and like the narrative of Atlantica as we go on. So another body of work that I have is reporting Earth history from the perspective of a alien, but like Atlantica, like the whole vibe of Atlantica is very flamboyant and extra. So we don't have just plain documents when we're like reporting human Earth. So this is like a factual historical document reporting the Queen. And we have some Chinese knockoff fabric with some Chinese knockoff pearls. So this is in Ghana, like in the neighborhood that I stay a lot, which to give you an idea, Ghana is a very like conservative post-colonial country, very similarly to the Bahamas. So both in Ghana and in the Bahamas, we have colonial laws that are against homosexuality. Even if culturally the youth no longer believe in those things, it tends to be the case that the older generation is still in control of our government. Like there are people in the government in the Bahamas that I memorized in fourth grade that are still there. And African governments just don't, they can be voted out and will just refuse to leave. Like the army will have to come in and take them out of the castle. So I saw this billboard when I was there and I stopped to take a picture of it. And the only reason I took a picture of it is because one, Printex is an African wax fabric company, but it's the only like African owned Ghanaian owned wax fabric company, which I thought was interesting. It's still marketed to the rich Ghanaians, right? So the average Ghanaian wouldn't be able to afford the fabric. But the other thing I found interesting about this billboard is that let's analyze this. And I want you to pretend that you live in a country where like being gay is illegal. So anything around that idea is like looked down upon. We have two women. We have cleavage. Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. Look at that. All of that. Oh, and look at them looking at each other. They can't be sisters. They can't be sisters. And why is she wearing pants and a suit? You know, like every time I go to Ghana and I get clothes made, the woman who makes my clothes, she'll give me a long lecture when I show her the pictures and she'll just be like, ah, why don't you let me make you a dress? Why do you always want to wear pants like a man? And I'm just like, because I am, that's why I want to say to like freak her out and just be like, because I am one. But like, really, I just tell her like, I don't like wearing pants. Like, that's not a thing where I come from. That is like, gender binaries are so set in stone in these countries. And I say my own country too, because like, when I go home, I have a saturation point. It's about 7 days where like a local bus driver screams a homophobic slur across the street. And I'm just like, ready to go back to the US. Let's go. Where's my plane ticket? It's too much, because it's like you go back in time. And when I took this picture, there was a guy who was following me on the road trying to sell me a belt the whole time. And so when I stopped to take this picture, he sucked his teeth really loud. He went, I don't know why they put these things here. And I was like, what things? And he's like, these lesbians. And then he went on this rant about lesbianism and how it destroys everything. And I was like, do you want me to buy a belt or not? Because like, but that was an interesting thing that I saw. And to put this into context, this part of Ghana is considered the tourist center. So tourists stay here. All the good hotels are here. I like to stay here because the artists also live here, right? So I'm going there to see my friends. So I thought, okay, well, this is a good progressive place to put this. It was gone in a day. The next day it was taken down. So I went out and found the photographer who did the ad campaign. And I wanted to redesign the ad to make it more digestible. And then I started thinking about how we are in the Caribbean, where like if anyone gets famous outside of the Caribbean, we claim them. Everyone in the Caribbean claims Grace Jones. So that's the idea of like, oh, if you're a celebrity, you get a pass, right? So we know Nina Simone and Grace Jones were queer. We know that now. But that's not something that someone from the Caribbean is gonna like even acknowledge. because we don't want to acknowledge that we can have icons that are also queer. So I thought I would just clip art a socially acceptable queer icon on the face of the Ghanaian model, because maybe if it's not someone who looks like us and it's a celebrity and they're other than, it's more acceptable. So this is like a series of redone appropriated ads. The text says, how to speak truth to power is refuse to cower. It's all hand sewn. This is a drawing with hand sewn text, hand painted glitter, decoupage of the original ad. And I don't have very good images of this because it's gone. So then I did a printmaking residency at the Center for Contemporary Printmaking. And now I'm taking directly from Vlisco. So remember I talked about Vlisco, the Dutch fabric company that just omnipotently created African wax fabric? This is like one of their buses that they have on their website that they use as like this video propaganda to be like, look at how old our company is. We've been making fabric from so long ago. And it just happened out of nowhere. We didn't take it from anyone. Nobody inspired us. So I made my own ads. Vlisco. This is a CMYK screen print with screen printed glitter sewn into reversible sequins. I always have to mention grad school trauma when I get to this piece, because like in grad school, the way our grad school was set up, we had a committee, like all of the faculty met once a semester to tell you whether you were good or not, whether you had classes with them or not, or whether they knew what you were making work about. It was a review situation where they would review all of the MFA students. And printmakers were always telling me I needed to frame my work on paper. Graphic designers were always telling me that I was using the wrong kerning, and painters were telling me one thing. And so like a lot of my work has things in it for those people. Like all of my text usually runs off the page, because I remember one graphic design professor in particular said that like that bothered her, and I was like, well, I'm just gonna do all of it then all the time. And then like the whole framing things was a big problem for me in school, because my professors always wanted things framed, and I was always the poor scholarship Black student, and I was like, I don't have money for that. So in my own work, I always make agreements with the master printers before we work on a project so that they know I'm not going to be framing the prints. They're probably going to be sewn into something. This is the second piece. I always work in multiples of two. I do have a background in printmaking, but people always ask that. As you go on to see other works, you'll see that there's two of everything. And this is in shag. This was another project I did at the Printmaking Center. It's a CMYK print, 30 by 40, I think. And the corners are also CMYK prints on wax fabric, hand sewn into the corners. And these are them sewn in to the frames. Question, when I show you my screen, and I don't know this, can you all see yourself on the side of my screen, or can you see the full screen?
I see a strip of people. I've got it set up so I see a strip of people.
Okay.
Side. Yeah.
Okay, all right. This is also a part of the historical document series of Atlantica. I had to give a report on Earth's feminist movement. And I had a hard time finding a lot of Black women, so I just superimposed groups of Beyoncés on top of all of the faces. Groups of Solanges also contributed greatly to the women's suffragette movement. These are photopolymer plate prints that I made that are sewn into glittered resin panel. My work is very hard to photograph. Like if you saw this, if you want to see this in person, it's currently on exhibition at Gavlak Gallery. in LA, but it's like shiny. Like all of my work has like texture sex going on. This is the first piece I did in the Colonial Swag series, which I'm really investigating. Colonial Swag is a high fashion brand on Atlantica that uses fully sustainable colonialism from Earth as a raw material. So we colonize colonialism to make products. And this is another Vlisco ad that's been appropriated. Whenever you see Royal Crown coming up in my work, it's serving multiple functions. Like Royal Crown is something that we use a lot in our hair in the Black community. And the company itself is very strange. It's a company that has only ever made Black hair products. And I'm not talking about like just random Black hair products. I'm talking about Black hair products that play a huge role in Black history and a huge role in like our culture. But the company has never been owned by a Black person. It was started by a white man. And his origin story is very mysterious. So like, I'm still doing research because I'd like to know, like, how did you come up with the formula? Who helped you with the formulas? Why are you interested in, most of these products are to tame Black hair, you know, like smooth it out. So I genuinely want to know, because it's like, who thinks that way to help or to hurt or to reinstate? Like what was the objective behind that? And why is it still a big company to this day? These are digitally printed and woven blankets that when I install them in exhibition spaces, they're installed on a tension wire to emulate a clothesline, and they're adhered with giant golden clothespins. So I'm going to give you a vibe right now. It's a vibe.
What did you say to your family found out you were going to be a drag queen? But you are.
I'm not a drag queen.
Well, you are sometimes.
When he put on dresses and drag, real drag, I mean, he looked better than me.
He loved to shop. That was his middle name. And he would say, I'm shopping for Jesus, girl.
I don't know how many of you know Sylvester, but I'm obsessed and I love her music. And I also like, I have other bodies of work. I couldn't put it all in this, but I have other bodies of work where I'm examining John Waters and Divine and the concept of like gender fluidity and gender queerism, like at the beginning where she was like, well, how did you know you wanted to be a drag queen? He's like, I'm not a drag queen. I'm like this persona. I'm this actor. I'm this character. Like, don't label me. So, you know, Sylvester is the Minister of Tourism on Atlantica. Hard to see again, but there's like glitter fabric hand stitched in the piece. So now I'm going to start introducing to like actual Atlanticans. Like these are actual people from my planet.
A motherfucking fat girl, okay? I'm fat. You like that? You like that? I'm fat. You like that? Mm-hmm. I know you like that. You like that, don't you? You like that I'm fat? I know. I'm fat, motherfucker, what's up? Don't be trying to play the fat girl today, okay? We are something amazing. We're the shit.
Okay, and then.
Oh, fat motherfucker, what's up? I am a
motherfucking fat girl, okay? I'm fat. You like that? You like that? I'm fat. You like that?
Mm-hmm. I know you like that. You like that? You like that? I'm fat.
I'm fat, motherfucker. What's up? A motherfucking fat girl, okay? I'm fat. You like that? You like that? I'm fat. You like that?
Mm-hmm. So, Astra is in the first video. Gervais is in the second. And I discovered Astra through Gervais because her song went viral. And like, these are the same women that are in the same online communities that I'm in and that I'm now friends with, and that like we have conversations about Atlantica and wanting to go back and ready to be done. This is a watercolor drawing sewn into reversible sequins. There's those multiples of two. More Atlantican portraits. This is the Dreamer series. These are Dreamer. That's my brother. He's technically a Dreamer because he was born in the Bahamas. And Blanca, one of my oldest students, who just got her green card under Trump administration. And now we're getting into the newer work. I'm coming back to the Atlantican protest posters. And the people that I'm focusing on this time are actual people that I know and who share the ideologies rooted in being from Atlantica, feeling like an outsider, queer. This is a watercolor pencil drawing under resin, sewn, hand-sewn fabric with oil paint and pasto. This piece is called You About to Lose Your Job Because You Are Detaining Me for Nothing. And same process. So we're coming back to colonial swag. This is a large 6x9 foot drawing with fabric stitched in. This is holographic glitter fabric sewn in. The person, the character in this portrait is a musician called One Love, the Kubler. He's a West African artist, and they have a band called Fucking Boys. And like, they're constantly being harassed by the government and by like venues because the venues accuse them of being gay, even though they don't really have identifying labels. They do make songs about post-colonial laws against homosexuality. But the music is really good if you want to look them up. You can search them by just typing F-O-K-N-B-O-I-S. So now I'm going to show you where I'm at now and why I'm not really going to be in any shows coming up, because I have my first solo museum show at the California African American Museum. And I'm really excited because I might get to meet Janelle Monáe because she found out about the project. And like, obviously we're both aliens and I just really want to meet her. But it's an installation with like tons of drawings, tons of tapestries. I'm just going to show you some sneaks here so you can see what my process is like with, just to give you more information about my background. I didn't really have money to go to school. I grew up really poor. So my process and the way I work hasn't changed. Even when museums are like, here's a budget, and it's way more money than I could ever imagine to spend on art supplies, I still work cheaply and in a process, in a way that alleviates mistakes as much as possible. So when I was in school, I made sure to learn digital output a lot, like film, graphic design, Photoshop, anything that I could learn while I was in school that would help me premeditate, like plan out my art so I wasn't wasting supplies. And it's a good skill to have because museums will give you a very reasonable budget, but that's budget, that's just one budget. Like you can't go over it and you don't have a lot of room to test. So this is going to be a wall in the exhibit that has purple fur. So the whole wall, what you're seeing is purple, is going to be fur. And the prints are going to be high glossy prints that are pressed into the fur against the wall and adhered to it with staple guns, like staples. But the staples are going to be close together so they look like stitching. And they'll also be golden. I'm reading Dune right now and I love it so much. If you read or if you like sci-fi, I highly recommend Dune. I guess I was reading about it on Wikipedia and it's considered the best science fiction novel of all time. And I've been so I haven't wanted to read it so long because for some reason it never caught me in my lifetime where I could understand it. Like reading it was very confusing, but I'm listening to the audiobook and it's a lot more coherent. So this piece is called The Real Dune. It has Gervais and Astra again, but you know, Gervais is rocking her, what's it called, CPAP machine thing. And like, these are appropriate. Like I put together the background of Namibia, which is how I imagine the Gilda region, which is the title of my show on Atlantica, would look like. But in essence, like this digital collage is what they posted. I colorized Astra. But these are deities in this specific region that I'm focusing on for the museum show. And they all know each other. Like they're all part of the body positivity movement on Instagram. Like all of those influencers you see, I'm in their DMs and like working through Atlantica with them. This is going to be a drawing. The royal crowns are going to be digitally printed and hand sewn in. This is the second sister piece to the first piece that you saw. So just so you can see what they look like before I actually start on them. And this is, so on Atlantica, we've only ever had one war. And the war was between two groups of people who could not agree on whether boneless chicken wings were actually chicken wings. So that's like the biggest war we've ever had on our planet. The bone and chicken wing people won and they got a chicken wing memorial forest for it. And that's what this is depicting. This is like a little, what's the terminology? It's like a joke that I have with all of the people in my work because my friends and I, we don't argue about big substantial things. We argue about food, like where we're going to go to eat food and then like whether a hot dog is a sandwich or not. And like, how dare you suggest such a thing? And it's like, those are the kind of things that we imagine would be the biggest turmoil and the biggest conflict on Atlantica. Like, imagine if that was the biggest thing you had to fight with someone about. This is going to be a giant four-piece drawing. And these are more Atlanticans, but on Earth, you would know them as the Colored Girls Rodeo. They're the only Black woman participating in competing rodeo in the U.S. But they're also Atlanticans, and I'm happy that I found them. These bars here will be sewn sequins. So this is going to have a lot of sewing, and they're going to be sewn around so that all of these pieces you're seeing will be hung from tension wires so you can see the front and the back. And the way I sew, the back ends up becoming a drawing of in and of itself with the thread. This is ending the show. And then I have some like imagery that's going to construct this planet a little bit more, but also tying in myself. This building here is the Pompeii Museum in Nassau. And me and my friends always found this place kind of weird because like we went there when we were in school for field trips, but it's situated downtown Nassau where like, it's like, there's like a bar next door that's known for having drunk tourists all the time. It's right in the touristy area where like people are handing you Bahama Mamas and stuff. And it's a place where like tourists are encouraged to go while on their vacation, but it's like a museum about Caribbean slavery. And it's like this visual metaphor on how, like, in general, the Black diaspora sees Caribbean slavery. So when I went to Africa the first time and I told them I was from the Bahamas, they were like, oh, you did better than your African-American brothers and sisters then. And I was like, what does that mean? Because, like, there's this misconception that Caribbean slavery was better than American slavery and Brazilian slavery, and that's like slavery has degrees of like flavor, like this tasted better than the other because all you had to do was get sugar cane. And I don't know, like, it's always been like this absurd thing that people who are actually from the Caribbean don't understand, because it's like we didn't end up any better than African Americans. Like, slavery still disenfranchises like a whole generation, and it keeps going and going and going. So like, it doesn't matter if we had crystal clear water and like beautiful beaches, our ancestors were still like slaves. So like, that's like the aesthetic of these like tropical countries. If you guys go on vacation, you can see these things hidden amongst, you know, the Bahama Mamas, and it's quite absurd. And then I'm gonna end with a video that is going to be in the front part of my installation. So my installation for the museum is going to have about 100 plants as a portal. So you have to go through the portal first to get to the actual planet, and the portal is made up of plants. So you're going to enter this humid room, and there's going to be video installations inside. And this video installation is of me growing the plants to this specific music. And the music is from a band called Super Mama de Jambo, and it was a band that like created one album and then just disappeared. Nobody really knows who the members are, and it's like strange music, and it's from Guinea-Bissau. So that room is going to be filled with over 100 plants that are specifically grown for the show by a Black-owned nursery. And at the end of the show, we're giving the plants away to anyone who needs it for self-care. And that's that. Thanks.
Awesome. Thanks so much, April. This is so wonderful to see. And congratulations on the museum show and also Gavlak. That's amazing.
Thank you. I'm excited. I have a lot of work to do.
Yeah, for sure. All right. Well, let's open it up to some questions. Does anybody have anything you can ask over Zoom? You can do it in the chat. Whatever's clever for you. And don't be shy.
I have a question. Hi. I was wondering, because you had talked a little bit about your interest in like the internet in terms of like YouTube and then using like viral videos. I was wondering if you had anything more to say about like how that connects to your current work.
Yeah, like it's an alternative space. I know a lot of you are probably Gen Z, but like I'm a millennial, and when I was in grad school, I started exploring the idea that like my generation kind of got pushed out of college, and we were forced to go to college. And then when we were pushed out of college, they were just like, sorry, the economy's crashed, like figure it out. You can do it, figure it out. And social media became something that our generation created for our generation with the like specific purpose of finding jobs, right? So that's how you have the concept of an influencer, and you have like all these brand identities and like these YouTube channels. Like one of the YouTubers that I followed in grad school, who's now huge, I don't know if you guys watch Philip DeFranco or Casey Neistat, like that idea was something that I was interested in, and that came out of like pure depression of feeling like the generation that told me I had to go to college didn't really prepare for me to utilize what that did, and I was like really upset about it. Now the online community is a space to, I don't know, like to rectify and to repair the physical spaces. For me, academia was extremely traumatic, and I didn't really, like, I learned a lot, but I, no one ever looked like me, and no one ever cared about what I was making work about. And so online was and still is a place where you can go to connect and find people who look like you and who care about the same things you care about. So yeah, like my entire solo show at CAM includes influencers. Like they're all influencers. They're all huge. Like I tell them not to share my stuff, even though I'm sharing with them, because when they do, like in that 1 hour they share it, there's like a whole bunch of people that are coming over to my Instagram like, oh my God, can you do a piece of me? And like, how do you know Astra? And how do you know? I'm just like, I've known these people before they became influencers because I was studying them. And it's now become something that like I communicate, like I have meetings with other artists all over the world now because of what I'm doing. It's most of it's done over Instagram. Instagram, ironically, is the best way to have video conversations with people in West Africa. We don't know why, but Skype, Zoom, nothing ever works well on the internet. So it's like, it's a big part of my work. And we're discussing now on how to create hashtags and an actual online space for the exhibition to be, so that people can, because we want, since a lot of influencers in my show, what I want is influencers to show up and to shoot themselves on Atlantica like they would when they go to those like crappy Moroccan places, but they only take pictures by the pool. And then when you go to stay there, it's like they have bed bugs and it's horrible, but the influencer got paid to make the photo. So I'm really interested in that, like, fake, yes, I love this hair product, and they've never used it, and it makes everyone's hair fall out. So, like, that's kind of the gimmick I want, is that some of these influencers show up, and they take pictures in, like, a bathing suit in front of one of the blanket pieces, and they're like, oh my God, I love it here, I've loved it so much. Like, Tulum, you know, like, have you guys seen how big Tulum is? Everyone's going to Tulum, right? They have the highest COVID cases now because of that. And I'm sitting here talking because I was trying to go for my birthday, but like, that's what I'm interested in now, is like all of these influencers. I don't know if you guys are friends with influencers, but they're different than what is Instagram shows. They're completely different. And I'm interested in that because I feel like that's the way my generation and the generation under us communicates. It's a form of communication. And I think that's definitely relevant in my work now and always will be.
All right. Anybody else? Other questions?
Hi. Thank you so much for your talk. I was just wondering. Sorry. I was just wondering, when is your show at CAM scheduled for?
March 3rd, if everyone can stop being gross and like put on their masks and stuff. It's like all the museums. So right now, so you guys know, the museums are in this limbo where they can't open because they're not classified like galleries are. So they're classified, I think, I don't even know what they're classified as, but they're trying to change their classification so they can open, so people can book times to go to museums. So I'm waiting to hear back from that. They told me to just make the work. So March 3rd is when it's supposed to open. If it gets pushed back, it's because the museums haven't opened yet. Technically, the museum's closed. So, yes. March 3rd.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for giving this talk. I have curly hair and I love all things fabric, but I also work at Goop and work in like beauty and interiors. And I was wondering, would you ever like create packaging for like R&Co or like another hair care line and do like a specific line for like African American women?
Yeah, I would be up for that and have attempted to do stuff like that before, but my requirements never get met. Like, I only do stuff for Black owned, and even before, and even into that, I focus on women or queer women. So I have like all of these like focuses that rarely are able to be met by corporations or anything incorporated. I'm open to it, but yeah, that's it. It doesn't usually work. I'm lucky to have a full-time job, so I use my art 100% to like have money funneled back into the people that I'm working with, uh-huh, or to amplify something I care about that Got meets it. Those requirements. Yeah.
I love that and respect that for sure.
Totes.
Thank you. All right. Anybody else? I see Ty's got a hand raised.
Hey, April, that was amazing. Thank you. I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about all the like the sequence and the texture and the fur and when all of that actual like heavy texture and this sort of like desire for us to like touch the piece and pet the piece like came into the work.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of defiance in my work, especially when it comes to materials and process. And again, that's going back to, now I'm an educator and I want to decolonize everything. So like I'm on a hiring committee and they're like, oh, we don't want to hire the ceramicist because he doesn't have a lot of wheel throwing in his portfolio. And I'm like, I was a drawing major and did no drawing in my personal work until recently, but I still got hired as the drawing professor because I know how to teach draw. You know what I mean? Like, it's things like that that I've always had a hard time with, and not necessarily because I want to be a contrarian. It's because I want to understand why someone's telling me to do something. Because oftentimes when I'm being told to do something, I can't do it in the way they want me to do it because I'm technically a disabled artist. I have like all of these different backgrounds that I have to consider. And usually when people say something is supposed to be done a certain way, those rules are created for the people who sat at the table and made the rules in the first place. And they very, very seldomly are me, right? So when I was in school, I went to school really because I wanted to know what books to read. I always read. I wanted professors to teach me how to learn. Instead, I got a lot of really toxic classmates and professors that taught me what they learned and how to do what they learned. And so like, and I'm willing to admit that maybe I have a learning disability and that type of teaching doesn't work for me, but it didn't work for me. And so when professors would say, you know, this is a painting, it's supposed to be on the wall, I would want to know why. Because I can't hang this painting on by myself. So can I lean it on the floor and make it a piece about, you know, grounding and like, can I accommodate this, what you're asking me to do, so it works for me? And I wouldn't have had a problem if the answer was, yeah, like make it work for you. It was always, no, this is what painting is. This is what printmaking is. This is what sculpture is. Like I clearly from seeing my work have a love for graphic design. But graphic design in both of my schools were completely kept separate from fine art. Even though most graphic designers had to take the introductory foundation classes with the rest of us, then they scattered. And I was like, but why is that different? because then it creates this anxiety to ask for permission to use graphic design, being told that your work is not good because you didn't follow X, Y, and Z rules. And again, coming back to the idea that those rules were never created to accommodate anyone that looks like me or exists in my body. So that's why I play with different techniques, in particular, the feminine processes versus masculine in academia really bothered me. The whole idea of you're sewing to be feminine. I'm like, I'm sewing into wood. Like how are we defining techniques as having gender? And so like to combat the men, I did more feminine processes, and to combat the women, I learned how to weld. Like that's the defiance. I call it defiance, but mostly based in the fact that nobody ever gave me answers that I felt were reasonable to alter my behavior to fit what they were telling me to do. It's like, sometimes I would have professors tell me to do something a certain way, and by accident, I would discover that the other way was cheaper and safer, and because I didn't do it their way, it was a problem. And they allowed that to impact my grade, even though the same outcome was accomplished. It's, for me, my practice is my practice. If I say it's a painting, guess what? It's a painting. And the only person who has the authority to define that is me. But I had to get out of grad school to understand that. I had to get out of academia to understand that. And that's also the way I teach. And that's like why I wanted to be a professor, because if students don't learn how to learn, then they think that what they make is wrong because the rules that came on a piece of paper, they were unable to follow. So I don't know if that answered your question, but.
No, for sure. That was, yeah. Thank you.
Hey, anybody else have any questions?
Hi, I do. Hi, I'm Gretchen April. I'm a colleague of Ty and Kate. First of all, thank you for sharing your work, and thank you for sharing your lived experience as well as an artist and as a student and all of that. I think it's incredibly valuable to hear your story along with how and what you're thinking about with your work. But I was wondering, is there anything you could talk a little bit about the sewing process? So you've talked about sewing and you like resin poured and wood and whatnot. Like, are you hand sewing? Is there a machine? Like, how, what does that look like for you? I imagine you have massive thimbles on your fingers. I don't know. Like, what does that process look like?
It's madness. I'm like one mad bombaclat yell. It's hand sewing. It's hand sewing and hand drilling, and it's absurd. And I actually blame my Ghanaian friends, because they were the ones that were like, you can do it. Like, West Africans have this like way of going through the world where they're just like, I'm just going to do it. And if it doesn't work, I'll fix the problems. And if it burns down, then we'll light something else on fire. So yeah, it's hand sewing. It comes from my background in the Bahamas. In the Bahamas, in primary school and high school, there's a huge focus on home ec with the track to get us to go into the hotels, right? So all of us are trained to be very worshiping of tourism and tourists, which is why I hate tourism and tourists. But the home ec, like, how do you cook? How do you present your cooking? And then sewing. I have particularly traumatic memories of the forced sewing projects that we had to do and how I constantly failed them because I was scared of the sewing machine. So I would like cheat and hand sew when I went home, but it never worked out properly. And so that's like another like remnant of colonial education that I'm bringing into my practice. There is no way to use a machine to sew into the resin. I have a quilting frame that I use to sew into my fabric pieces. But in general, it's painful, tedious, and not very sustainable. So I'm working on like, I don't do like a million pieces in one go, but there's also some ideals around labor, exploited labor, and conversations that I had with the actual women that I purchased fabric from. When it comes to work ethic and integrity around using source material, do you hire someone to do it? Where do you come in if you do that? And I made the decision for myself that the labor has to be done by me. I have studio assistants who cut all the pieces out, but I'm the one sitting there. On average, each piece takes between 300 and 800 hours of sewing, but I'm good at it. Like, I do it fast, but yeah, that's how it physically works out.
What is it like? Are you using massive needles? Are you like
leather needles? I use leather embroidery needles with embroidery thread. But my work is rule-based too, if I didn't mention that before. So all of the materials have to be made in China. So that adds to the obnoxiousness, because like they don't have any quality at all. Like the needles break a lot. The thread breaks all the time. But yeah, it's just, I have rigs set up in my studio where I have lights on the bottom of the table. So I'll pull the painting towards me and the light will shine through so I can see the holes. And yeah, it's absurd. But there's always like an end sexy fetish finish situation that I'm going for. And that does come from like I have a series called Articulate, where it has like famous Black authors with the word articulate underneath, because like I get called articulate a lot, and like every time someone's like, oh, you're so articulate, I imagine someone petting me on the head and being like, look, you're such a cute Negro. You know how to say the word assimilation. And I'm just like, what do I do with that? Like, how do I articulate that, you know, I have brought up C. When I came from the Bahamas, I skipped a grade. The U.S. education system is not where it should be. That's just the truth. But when I got here, all of my American teachers assumed I would be like more stupid than everyone else. So they didn't understand, like, you know, where I was. So it's not an easy process, but the process not being easy is part of the work, I think. And then wanting people to be seduced by the process is also part of it, because everyone is super hella capable of admiring sexy art without touching it. Just like they're capable of admiring kinky twists without touching them, you know? So hope I answered your question. It's not the smartest process, but it produces the outcome I want.
Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Great. I want to be cognizant of time here. Anybody else? And maybe a last question. Otherwise, I'm going to steal it for myself. Oh, no, we got one here in the chat. Do you feel there's a level of miscommunication that occurs between your work and people viewing it who don't have the same background as you, especially when you cannot give the context behind it in person?
I don't, because I consider the audience when I make my work, and there's multiple nuggets in the work. So at the very least, you can look at the work and appreciate it for its aesthetic. That's the first level of concentration I make. That also comes from my background being in the Bahamas. Our houses are pink and teal. Like, it's that my work looks like where I grew up. But you don't need to know that to know that it's good color theory. And some of my work has celebrities in it. Whether you know who they are or not, there's always text that accompanies it as well. So there's a lot of nuggets. I don't understand every art piece I see and every artist that puts work out there, but I do think it's our responsibility to give enough visual cues to either entice someone physically, like how they feel or how they're like interacting with the piece, or where they can like pick up on something from the language or the expression or the person they're seeing or the color palette they're seeing, the brand that they're seeing. I go with the premise that my audience, you, are smarter than maybe you give yourself credit for. I do not make art from the premise that the audience is ignorant and stupid and they can't pick up on things. And I noticed that some artists do make work that way, and they're too heavy-handed and they're afraid people aren't gonna get their work. But I can sleep if people don't get my work. I can sleep at night because I'm interdisciplinary, and that's like a big, like that's also a big hurdle for people getting consistency with my work, because I work in different mediums. But the style is the same, hey. Like, did you guys see a very drastic difference in style amongst the different bodies of work? There's still that hypersaturation of color. I feel like the style carries itself to where people at the very least can enter into the work just looking at what it looks like. You have to see it in person too. Most people just get the work and like it because it stands out against the wall and they can sit with it for longer than 30 seconds. That's my main goal, really, is how long will people sit with the work? It could remind them of what they need to buy at the grocery store for dinner that night. I don't really care. But they're engaging with it for longer than 30 seconds, right? So I would argue that if your work does need the context for people to get, or if there is a miscommunication has to happen with communication first. And I don't think my work miscommunicates anything. At the very least, there's enigma or like mystery, but I'm not communicating something that's misdirecting. And, or at least I don't think so. This could be like an interesting time to define if you think there's a level of miscommunication, because the question says, do you feel there's a level of communication? My answer is no, I don't, because there's so many levels. So if you're miscommunicated to on one level, head on over to the color, you know, or head over to the glitter. Glitter is there because glitter is our currency in Atlantica. Almost all of my work is presented with the narrative of Atlantica as well, in the form of an artist statement, if that makes sense. And the titles, I didn't go over titles, but the titles are also very conceptual to the piece that gives more meaning. So like my answer is multiple. Like, it's not binary. You guys should never say my work is about this. How do I make it about this? Because it's about more than this. Because you're more than this, right? I hope. So there's multiple levels. And if you don't get any of those levels, that's a level in and of itself. There.
I love that. Awesome. Thanks so much. Well, I think we actually are a little bit over. So I just wanted to say thank you so much, April. My class and some of the other seniors have some studio visits coming up, but thanks so much to everyone who attended. This was just really wonderful. I think this was just so great for everybody.